What if there were things that you were doing on a daily basis that were either boosting your mitochondria or draining your mitochondria, and you could make those into habits that were easy to implement and effective to improve your health? I'm sure you'd be interested in knowing which habits were supporting and which ones weren't. And that's exactly what I'm going to be showing you on this video. So let's dive in. Hi, my name is Dr. Joel Rosen, and I'm a professional rejuvenation health coach. And I help modern day health exploring men and women that are on a quest to be able to tap into their fountain of youth so that they can show up each and every day at their best. And on this video, I want to talk to you about the six habits that you could easily implement in your life to be able to boost your mitochondria. And if you're not aware of them, they're actually draining your mitochondria. So number one has to do with minerals. It comes down to your body's ability to make energy. And if we're talking about the mitochondria and we don't get too much into the weeds with the science, we know that there's five complexes that helps to make the most amount of energy in cellular respiration. And if we're not able to effectively bounce those electrons and we spill off a lot of free radicals, then we're draining ourselves of energy. On the other hand, if we are effectively creating that passing of electrons down that gradient pump, then we're creating a great amount of energy and we're minimizing the amounts of free radicals that are spilling off on that. But when it comes down to the science and keeping it simple, we need to make sure that we're getting enough minerals and we're getting enough positively charged and negatively charged chemical bond structures that are happening in order to make this symphony play beautiful music. And that doesn't have to be overthought. It's just eat healthy foods, breathe healthy air, and have the end product of energy be produced. In today's day and age, unfortunately, the food supply isn't very good all the time. And if we're not going out of our way to make sure we're diligent, then certainly we're getting exposed to processed, artificial, high fructose corn syrup, pesticides, chemicals, and very, very depleted in the nutrients that they do have in there. So you have to be very sure that you're going out of your way to get good quality foods that are made from the earth, whether they're red, yellow, purple, green. Conventionally grown is not ideal unless you know the farmer, and hopefully organically grown and minerally dense soils are what we are talking about in today's day and age. But many times that's just not enough. So I do recommend, if you have a high quality mineral source or you're getting a pink Himalayan salt, consult your doctor with any type of medical problems that you may be having, but make sure that you are getting deep amount of minerals in your foods or in your nutrients. Number two comes to caloric intake. The reality is, if you look at all longevity studies, there's no confusion about what promotes longevity, and it has to do with caloric restriction. And given that our food supply is very dense in calories, and they call it an obesogenic type diet, usually high fats, high nutrients, and it stimulates a lot of cellular growth. Along with mTOR pathways and the balance of AMPK to be able to create cellular breakdown and decrease senescent cells and all the stuff that goes along with that, one of the main reasons that keeping your caloric restriction to a baseline is you're not stimulating your mTOR consistently. So what I like to look at is your basal metabolic rate, or your BMR. And they have BMR calculators online that are fairly accurate and at least give you a ballpark based on your age, height, weight, sex. But what the real important biomarker is how active you are. So if you're very active, you are going to have a higher basal metabolic rate based on your activity levels. So let's say you're highly active, and that needs to be very accurate. And say, so for math's sake, it's someone like me and I need 2000 calories based on how active I am and what my basal metabolic rate is. And I should be at 25% less than that. So that would be 1500 calories. And that is the ideal way to be able to boost your mitochondria. Yeah, that doesn't sound too enticing to people, because when push comes to shove and you look at your caloric intake and you know exactly how much you're taking and you're restricting the amount of food that you're getting and you're already dealing with low energy, then you're going to be hesitant to do this. I would tell you that talk to your doctor again, but it requires diligence and understanding that you're unhealthy. And these six factors that we're explaining on this particular video is going to help you get everything in alignment, which puts more credence on number one and making sure that you're making every calorie count, that you have a restricted amount of calories, and with the depleted poor quality foods that we're already getting, you're gonna be hard pressed to keep up with the pace of what your body requires. And that gets into a whole other science and a whole other topic of supplements and nutrients and pharmaceuticals that you could be taking. Fourth habit that you need to be aware of is your exposure to light. Let's face it, in today's day and age, we are just bombarded by artificial light more than we care to admit, but more than we should be physiologically. So when there was no light bulb and the natural sunrise would wake us up and the natural sunset would have us go to bed, our body would calibrate with the circadian rhythm of the earth. And one of the best ways that we can recalibrate ourselves is by controlling our exposure to light so as natural as we can, because our body has been engineered to respond to those chemical messengers, melatonin, things like that, that help our body create this symphony. And when we are doing habits that aren't modulating the light at the right times, that's going to create a lot of drain to your mitochondria. So the way we look at it is get exposed to light in the middle of the day, get exposed to light if you can in the morning when it's first rising, and get exposed to the light at the end of the day when it's setting, so that you can calibrate your circadian rhythm. Vigilant as well about your exposure to blue light. So when the light goes down in the evening and you have your cell phone or you have your computer or you have your lamp or your TV light, chances are high that blue light is being emitted from any of those devices combined, and that's blocking your areas in your brain that release melatonin, and it tells your body that it's still daytime. So we have to be vigilant about those. The fifth factor really comes down to stimulants. Now, stimulants are around us all the time. If we think about our cell phone, we think about text messages, we think about emails, we think about social media, we think about business. We wear multiple hats with multiple tasks, with multiple stimuli, which really creates a stimulation of our sympathetic nervous system. And if we're looking to boost our mitochondria, we want to dial that down and be aware of it so that we keep it in a happy medium. Yes, it's important to have it. No, it's not important to have it all the time. Make sure that you're aware of how you release this. And that has to do with your chemical exposures that you're getting with synthetic foods and pesticides and sprays. And it has to do with any type of high fructose corn syrup or how much sugar that you're having or alcohol or nicotine or caffeine and how many windows and how many text messages. You have to be aware of all of those things and dampen those as much as you possibly can so that you boost your mitochondria in effective ways. And the sixth and final habit is, are you releasing this? What I mean by that is when you're charged up and your circadian rhythm is off and you're not getting a lot of minerals and your body is draining your mitochondria, then chances are that you're not releasing it effectively. And so by releasing it, I mean discharging, transferring that energy into something that's positive. So if it's being with your children, being with your community, being with your neighbor, being with your spouse, doing something you love, creating artistic things, listening to music, being social, all of those things are very therapeutic in helping your body release the drain and strain and adrenaline and excitatory neurotransmitters. Now, if you do all these six things, and you should start to feel a lot more energy and boost to your mitochondria. However, in many instances, you may still feel tired despite doing all these things. A very frequent question that I get is, are there any specific mitochondrial tests that you can run or do to determine the shape of your mitochondria? And I'll say, well, it's an amazing question. There's not one specific gold standard. Rather, there are a lot of different biomarkers that you can use inferences to be able to determine the state of the mitochondria. And we can measure these types of things in specific reactions and specific markers to determine, is there more smoke coming out of the tailpipe or are we making more energy? And that has a lot to do with free radical testing. And if you're interested to know how that works, check out our video on the best tests that help determine the state of your mitochondria. And until then, I'll catch you on the other side.
Hey there, I hope you're getting tremendous value out of our videos. If you are, make sure you like our videos, subscribe to our YouTube channel, turn on your alert buttons, and then check out the description below because I have a free masterclass that will teach you how to 10x your energy levels in the next 12 weeks and finally end your energy and exhaustion nightmare.